as old as dirt. I mean, literally, if you go back to Genesis with the first family, many of you know this story, but there's two brothers that bring their sacrifice to the Lord. One of them, God was very pleased with the sacrifice, the other, not so pleased. And instead of that brother that was disappointed, finding out how he could please God with his sacrifice, what did he do? He began comparing his life with his brother's life. It led to a lot of jealousy and ultimately murder. Now, I don't know if you deal with comparison in your life to that degree, but I think that we all deal with comparing at one level or another in our lives. And it may be, it could be possessions. Maybe you've had the opportunity to buy a new or newer car, and you're pretty proud of it. It still has some shine on it, only to find your next-door neighbor buys a 2017, decked out. It has every bit of little doohickeys on it that you wish you could have, and now all of a sudden, you look at your car, you want that car, but your car's upside down, and there's nothing you can do about it. Or maybe you're one of those ladies that you're looking at Instagram, and you pull up your friend's house, and it looks like Pinterest just threw up on it. I mean, it's perfect. And then you look over to your husband, and you say, look at there. Wow, look at what he made. Can you make this? And then I say, no, Trish. They've got a jigsaw, and they know how to use it. It's impossible. No human could make that. If you want that, we're going to have to go to Hobby Lobby. And I've heard in my house that, Barry, if you could just be more like Randy Staggs, and he's around this place, he's very handy. Me, not so much. Or maybe you're one of the ladies and you watch the commercial on television and you see the way the model is, her hair is wafting in the wind. And you wonder if your hair can waft and shimmer like that. And us guys, we don't have that problem so much. We're just worried about keeping everything rooted, keeping hair where hair is supposed to be instead of migrating all over our body where it doesn't belong. And now that I'm over 50, I have a little hedge trimming that needs to be done from time to time. Or maybe it is, my wife said, don't use that line. Or maybe it's events. You know that it used to be, back when I was young, it used to be that we would go to probably, like you do, one, maybe two weddings if you were unlucky a year. You would go to those weddings, and we didn't know that those weddings were absolutely lame by today's standard. Because now we go to a wedding every weekend. We're on Facebook, and I've seen the incredible pressure that people put themselves in now. Baby showers. Baby showers used to be some lemonade and we'll get together and play a game. And now it's got a theme. All the cupcakes stick with the theme. We got chalkboards. We've got all sorts of things happening that we never, ever had to deal with before because of comparison. And we compare our circumstances and life stage of life as well. And we look over at our life and we say, certainly by now I should have been further in my career, and they're dumber than me. I should be making more money than them, or they're not as pretty as I am. I'm prettier, and they're married and I'm not. Or we compare our marriage and we say, I wish my marriage was like theirs, or their kids are better. I wish my kids were better behaved like their kids. Or we look and maybe you look down and you say, I wish my husband was like their husband. And Trish looks down and sees the post and it's a perfect rocking horse and it is stained. And then she looks over at me and I'm on the couch, you know, with Cheetos on my chest and using the remote to change the channels for the game. The fact is that comparison can be very, very frustrating for our lives. And I believe that there is an underlying toxic tone to comparison that when we embrace it and buy into it, it can lead us to a very unhealthy place and rob the potential that God has for our lives. And so today, I want to begin with, if you have your notes ready, I want to look at some of the pitfalls of comparison, and I want to warn you, these are very simple once again. I actually believe that, sure, the Bible is deep, but what the Bible is telling us to do, after all, the Bible says these things are written that you might, what, guess or be confused? No, these things are written that you might know. And so what we know we're to do is not too hard to grasp from the Bible. The hard part is to do it. That's where the growth is. And so I'm going to remind you of some things that you probably already know, but it's good sometimes to be reminded to do what you already know you should be doing. So let's take a look at our notes. Now, when we compare, what is the toxic result? When we compare, that comparison is the death of wisdom. I mean, it kills intelligence. Paul said it this way, 2 Corinthians 10:12, it's in your notes. Paul said, we do not dare to classify or what? Compare ourselves. Now, here's the backstory. During Paul's day, very unlike today, there were preachers and others that were in the ministry that bragged about how many people they led to the Lord, about how many people were baptized, and what great things they did, how many churches they planted. They saw angels. And Paul said, I'm not going to have any of that. Nuh-uh, I'm not doing that. And then he said this. He said, because there are those, we don't compare ourselves to others. He said, because with some who commend themselves, you know, it's like those preachers. Now, I'm not going to complain, but that they're on Twitter, and they retweet things like, Pastor, that message moved me so much, and other compliments. And you see people that do the same. And it goes on to say, when they measure themselves by themselves and compare themselves with themselves, they're stupid. I mean, they're not wise. It's the death of intelligence. It'll rob meaning from your life. It'll steal from your marriage. It'll kill your potential. And I believe that when you compare, because we all have a tendency to do it, that when we compare, that there's only one of two ways that this whole thing can go. Now, we live in a culture that everybody wins. I mean, everybody gets a trophy. You all winners, but we know that that's just not the way life is, okay? Some of us, we win, and some lose. That's the way it is. But here's the deal. When you choose to compare yourself to others, in your mind, you set yourself up for loss or victory, winning and losing. You're either setting yourself up to be superior or inferior. And so they're in your notes, and I have to find my notes. Write this in the margins of your notes. Write this down. God will judge our lives based on the potential he gave us. Listen, when you stand before God, you're not going to have to answer for anyone's life that you compare your life with. And so I would say it's not wise to look at someone else and compare your life stage with their life stage, their opportunities, their circumstances, their success, their victories, their winnings, their success with your life. Because when you compare, it only has one of two ways to go. Either you lose or you win, inferior or superior. Now, when we feel superior, this is the fill-in for you. When we feel superior, comparison gives birth, and here's your fill-in, it gives birth to pride. And I absolutely love this scripture. Luke 18 and verse 11. Here you have this Pharisee. He's a religious guy, and this is what he does. He's standing by himself and he's praying. And what is he saying? He's saying, God, I am so thankful that I'm not like those other people. He's comparing himself. He says, I'm glad I'm not like that robber and the evildoer or those people that are sleeping around. I'm glad I'm not like them. And then the Bible says that he actually pointed at someone. And I don't know why this guy didn't clock him right in the nose, but he pointed at someone and he said, I'm glad I'm not like him. He's a tax collector. And then he took a big deep breath. And after all, I'm not like him. I fast 21 days during the 21 days of fasting and prayer. Well, I actually said I fast twice a week. And I tithe. I give one-tenth of all I own to the Lord. I'm thankful that I'm not like these other people. And we've all thought that. We might not say it all the time. I'm not like them, but we think it. And I can prove it to you before you had kids. Now, we've all been to Walmart. And you hear like this crash and crying and whining and screaming. There's a murder on aisle 13. And with all the other ambulance chasers, you take your cart and you want to see what's happening, only to look down at the ground and there is a three-year-old just crying out and whining and screaming bloody murder. And you think, what do you think? If that kid were my kid, they wouldn't be like that. Why, when I have kids, they're going to behave better than that, and I would teach them. But then you have kids. And the truth is that some three-year-olds become demon-possessed, and there's nothing you can do about it. And the thing with comparison is that it often blinds us. It blinds us of our own issues in our life. And perhaps maybe you're here on a Sunday morning, and we're praising and we're worshiping God. And then you leave this service to go out in the parking lot and you see one of the people that were worshiping God with you just moments ago, and now instead of lifting their hand for worship, they took it down here to take a draw. And what do? You say, I'm not like them. Don't they know that their body is the temple of the Holy Spirit? And you get in your car. Drive down the road, you pull up to the first drive-thru and you say, I'll have a double baconator with twice the cheese, please. Well, what do we, comparison, what does it do? It often blinds us to our own issues in our life. I love what C.S. Lewis said. He said this, we say that people are proud of being rich or clever or good-looking, but they are not. Just a moment. Pause. Look in the corner. Hope. Okay? That is my granddaughter right there, Rosemary. I want to welcome her, for she is a first-time guest, and I wouldn't want to not do that. Okay. All right. You may go now. Okay. C.S. Lewis, he said this. We say that people are proud of being rich or clever or good-looking, but they are not. They are proud of being richer, of being cleverer, or better looking than others. If everyone else became equally rich or clever or good looking, there would be nothing to be proud about. Now the truth is that when we feel superior, it brings pride. God said that he resists the pride of people when we look around and we try to evaluate our lives by pulling other people down to elevate ourselves. And so we all do it. I might not have my life together, but at least I'm not like them. Now the next one is, it's the second toxic response. When we feel inferior, a comparison gives birth to insecurity and jealousy. When we lose this, we feel insecure and jealous. I love this story, 1 Samuel 18:6. You've probably heard this story. When the men were returning home after David had killed the Philistines, you remember David, little shepherd boy, he took 5 smooth stones, it only took 1, he put it in a slingshot, he felled a giant, and now it says that because of this big victory, the women came out from all the towns of Israel to meet King Saul. What we have here is the after party. King Saul pulled up in the big jet, they've got the red carpet, and they're coming down, everybody's giving high fives, they're coming out to the big crowds, there's girls with pom-poms, and they're playing, na 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 na, hey, okay, and they're singing, and dancing, and joyful songs with tambourines and lutes, which were not as developed in that day as to have flutes. In verse 7, as they danced, they sang, Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000s. Na 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 boo boo. I didn't say this first service, but we used to have that cheer, go back, go back, go back to the woods. Your team's got no spirit. Your mother's no good. I mean, that's what they were doing right there. Verse 8, this made Saul very angry, and this refrain galled him. I mean, my mom used to say, you scared the liver out of me. The galled him means he was mad right down to his liver. And they have credited David with 10,000s, he thought, but me with only thousands. He thought they were going to take his kingdom from him. And verse 9, and from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. And what we learn here is that Saul is thinking, David, what's the big deal? I'm the one who gave him the opportunity to slay the giant in the first place. These women were not even there. What are they doing praising him and singing his song? They should be praising. If you remember the story, he put his heavy armor upon David and said, go fight. And David had to talk him into using his own anointing and his own method for a new generation. And then David did the victory. And now Saul is saying, come on, man. I'm the one who put him in position for success in the first place. Now, what we learn here is a very important lesson, I believe, about leadership. Are you ready for what it is? Weak leadership is very insecure. You know what strong leadership does? It raises up the people around them. In fact, I would say that it would believe that they should equip, empower, identify, so the next generation would find hope. But that's not what Saul did at all. Instead of lifting up, instead of raising up and drawing him close, after all, if he would have held David close to him, he could have taken credit. He could have said, come on now, let's sing together, because after all, he's on my team together. I'm the leader of the team, you see? David, good guy. In fact, if Saul had a brain in his head, he would have employed that little shepherd boy in every battle and kicked some rear end and took the credit. But instead, he was worried that his kingdom would be taken away from him, that they're lifting up someone else. But strong leadership is not insecure. In fact, insecurity is always co-joined to its inseparable twin, jealousy. And we need to allow other people around us to be raised up to help us. In fact, write this in your margins. Are you ready? If I resent God's goodness in others, I will miss God's blessing in me. I'll say it again. If I resent God's goodness in others, I will miss God's blessing in mine. Now, if you start thinking, oh no, I couldn't kill a giant like that, and I can't swing a slingshot like that, that what will happen is insecurity will rise, and pretty soon you're pushing away the people that God called to be in your life to help you. And we see this all the time. Pay attention. Are you ready? I'm going to tell you something you already know. We see this all the time in ministry. We see it in the corporate world. What happens is somebody starts to go further and shine brighter than the leader, and that leader begins to think, oh no, they're starting to get the accolades. Oh, my position might be in peril because now they're doing such a good job, and so they start pushing them away and putting them down. But instead, we need to identify, equip, and empower. And if we do that and lift people up, they can help us, and we all win towards the potential that God has for our life. Now, there's only one of two ways that comparison can bring you, and one would be that you'd become prideful, the other would be insecure and jealous, and they will rob us from the potential in our lives. Now, I gave you this little blank in your notes, and it says, I often compare. I often compare. What is it that the Holy Spirit is dealing with you about? What is it that you often compare? Are you comparing houses? Are you a mom that's trying to balance everything and you find yourself comparing yourself against other moms? Or are you comparing things like your career, body shape, style, finances, title at the end of your name? What is it that you are losing this battle of comparison that's making you either feel prideful or it's causing you to push other people away. So I want you to fill that blank in. And here's the strange thing that I noticed, that Saul had no idea the background and the struggles that David had. He didn't see David when he was alone watching sheep on the back of the desert, and he didn't know all the daddy issues that David had when all of the brothers were brought in and one of them would be king to be anointed by the prophet. But where was David forgotten, not even thought about by his father? And here's the thing, is that David's story was not Saul's story, and Saul's story was not David's story. So what is it that you find yourself struggling for and losing in this battle? So what do we do now? Why don't you open up your Bible or flick in your gadget to John 21. And we're going to kind of answer, what do we do now? And in John 21, it's an amazing story. And we're going to end with it right now because it gives us a few clues on how we can win the battle of comparison in our lives. And it's an interesting story where we pop into in John 21 because this is a time in which Jesus had died and given himself on the cross. He had been raised from the dead. Now he's alive. And this is the most fascinating slice of time, especially if you're into quantum physics and things like that, because Jesus is just popping up. And then he's just like disappearing. He's walking through walls. And so here we are in John 21 at one of the last appearances of Jesus. Now, not all of the disciples were convinced that he had indeed been raised from the dead. In fact, some, like Peter, were hopeful that maybe he didn't, because if he was alive, he'd be very ashamed. And so here in this passage in John 21, you know what Peter says? He says, "I'm gonna go fishing." And it's funny that many times when people are in stressful situations in their life that they regress back to the things that they used to do that they know and they're familiar with. And here the disciples were concerned, like, how are we going to live life now without the master? Now that Jesus is gone, I mean, how can we put this thing together? And so Peter says, "I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go fishing." And the funny thing is that the disciples, they stunk at fishing. That before they were asked to follow Jesus, they sucked at fishing. They were terrible. They would stay up all night and not have a bite. And here we are again in this passage. "I'm going to go back and do what I used to stink at." Okay, and he's back there fishing, not finding a bite. And then all of a sudden they look over at the shore and there's somebody yelling. And it's Jesus. And he's saying, "Hey, other side. Cast the nets." And they haul in a record amount of fish, and they come ashore with Jesus. And this is one of the confirmations that Jesus Christ was raised physically in his body, is that Jesus partook in a fish fry. And they all ate together, and that's where we pick it up. If you look in your notes, it's there too, that they had breakfast with Jesus. And Jesus actually had this score to settle with Peter, because Peter had some areas of comparison in his life that he needed to work out, and it all came crashing down when Jesus was on trial at Caiaphas's house, and Peter denied Jesus on three separate occasions. So now you have Peter very, very messed up, very hurt inside, and Jesus knew that he needed to be repaired. And so if you look in your notes in verse 15, so after breakfast, they went on this walk, and Jesus asked Simon Peter, he said this, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" And on two separate occasions, we know in both Matthew and Mark that Peter responded this way. He said, "Peter, do you love me more than these other people?" Notice the comparison. What did Peter say? "Of course, I love you more than anyone else. They might all ditch you. They might all bail, but not me. I go to the death. There's no way that I am going to turn my back on you. I'm going to follow you to the bitter end. Verse 16, Jesus, he slaps Peter in the face and he says, "Do you love me?" And if you're taking notes, that word for love right there is the Greek word agape, and it means sacrificial, unconditional, perfect. The only way you can have this kind of love is if it's God-given. And Peter responds this way. He says, "Yes, Lord." Peter says, "You know that I love you." The kind of love there is the word in the Greek, phileo. It's where we get the word phileo fish. No, it's not. Okay. I don't know where that's coming from. But. Okay, it's the Greek word phileo that means loyalty or commitment. What was Peter saying? He says, and that was his problem. He says, "I love you in the way that I have to work for it." And then Jesus says this. He says, "Feed my sheep." And again, I find this just fascinating that Jesus' response to Peter in this first question of "Do you love me?" was, "Take care of the next generation. Let them find hope. Take care of my little lambs. Make sure that you feed them." And then I find it also interesting that Jesus did not refer to him as Peter. That was the name Jesus gave him. It meant the rock, but instead he appealed to his humanity. He called him Simon Peter. He appealed to the broken, the fallen humanity side of Peter. And he says, "Do you love me?" And what he's saying is, forget about everyone else. What he's saying is, forget about all these others. You said you'd love me more than all of them, but what about me and you? Do you agape me? Just between me and you. Forget about them. Do you love me? And then in verse 16, Peter responds a second time. He says, "I phileo you," with this commitment kind of love. And then again, Jesus says, "Feed my sheep." Verse 17, the third time Jesus, and we won't go through all the details of this story, but he asks it three times. He says, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" But this time, instead of, like the first two times, instead of saying, "Peter, do you agape me unconditionally? Do you agape me?" Second time. This time he says, "Do you phileo me? Do you phileo me, Peter?" So in the first time he's saying, "Yeah, I love you more than all of these." And the second time he says, "Can you commit to me personally?" And then here in this third time, what he is saying basically is, "Peter, do you even have affection for me?" Verse 17, this third time, Peter was very wounded. He was hurt that Jesus would ask him this question this third time. And he said, "Lord, you know everything. You know I love you." And what did Jesus say? "Feed my sheep." And then he said this, "Follow me. You follow me." Peter then made the same mistake over again. He made the same mistake we often make. And Peter turned and he looked behind him to the disciple that Jesus loved. And this is talking about John. And I know it's weird, but John often talked about himself in the third person. So Peter looks behind him, and who does he see? He sees Peter, and he says, "What about this guy, the guy that was at the Last Supper, and your beloved guy, and who will betray you?" And then in verse 21, Peter asked Jesus, and he said this, "What about him?" Isn't that the same mistake that you and I often make? God calls us to make a leap of faith, to step out, to give on that occasion, to start that ministry, to go ahead and involve yourself in that new venture in business, to take a risk, to follow him. And what do? When God calls us, he puts his finger on our life and he says, "I've got a call for you. You do this. You follow me." What do? We say oftentimes, we say, "What about them? How come you're asking me? What are they doing?" Verse 22, Jesus replied, "If I want him to remain until I return, what is it What is it to you? In other words, I love it when Jesus talks this straight. What is it to you? I've called you to do something. What does it matter if I allow him to live forever? What's that have any relevance into what I've called you to do? And so he says, you follow me. That leads me to two simple points, and we'll end here. And the first one is this, and it's a fill-in for you. What God is doing in someone else's life, are you ready for the fill-in? Has nothing to do with what God has called you to do. So here, God calls you to make the jump. God calls you to make the leap. He puts his finger on you and he gives you your calling. And what do we do? So oftentimes we say, but what about them? What is that person doing? Why are you calling me? How come you're giving them that opportunity? And Jesus is saying, that doesn't matter. What's it to you? I've called you. You follow me. You obey. And I love Ephesians chapter 2. It's there in your notes. It says, for we are God's handiwork. In the Greek, that means masterpiece or craftsmanship. It means that God has this idea that God intentionally formed you, that he put his abilities, his giftings in your life, that he knew what you would face in your day. And it says this, that he created you in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. In other words, he tailor crafted you. He made you to fit this day. It's like he looked through the eons of time and he saw a problem. This is the idea, that there was a problem that you would be created to solve, that you would be fitted, that you would be equipped to deal with that problem. And the problem or the issue with so many of us is that we look over oftentimes and say, God, how come I don't have that calling? How come you didn't make me for that problem? And here Jesus is saying, what is it to you? If I have Peter live or not, what relevance is it to you if that person wins the lotto or they have a bigger small group than you, or if they have better behaved kids, or if they're more successful? What we need to focus on, this is your last fill-in, and we'll close with this. What we need to focus on, what you need to focus on is this. Follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. What has he called you to? What has he created you to do? This church wants to identify. We want to equip. We want to empower you. But what has he called you to do? And the last scripture, and then we'll pray, Luke 9:23. Then he said to them all, he said, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their neighbor's cross. You take up your own cross and you do it daily and you follow him. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Lord, I pray right now that you would be in this moment. Lord, in all humility, we invite the power of your Holy Spirit to breathe upon our lives, to breathe upon our spirit. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to say we've had enough of comparison. Lord, I ask that you would forgive us for those times in which we've looked down upon others. We've pushed them down only to evaluate our lives by them and somehow gauge our lives and make ourselves feel better. And Lord, I pray that in your name that, Lord, we would not be jealous. Lord, that you would raise up in the midst of this church leaders that they're not threatened, but Lord, that we would identify and that we would lift each other up and help equip and empower, and Lord, that we would work together as a team for your kingdom's sake. And God, I pray that we would exist to see this next generation find hope. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, You know, comparison is a real difficult thing. That when we compare ourselves to other people, sometimes we feel better, and honestly, sometimes we feel worse. But there's one comparison that is really difficult. And I said it in this message that there's only one person that will have to answer for your life, and it's you. You only have to answer for your potential of your own life. And the Bible tells us that one day we'll stand before God, that He's holy, that He's perfect. And the fact is, the Scripture makes it very clear that each and every one of us, we lose out big time on that comparison. That each and every one of us have fallen. We've not lived up to that potential. In fact, the Bible calls it sin, and that's why Jesus Christ gave Himself on the cross. He died for every one of our shortcomings. He was buried. He rose again so that He could offer us life. That we could lose out and still win with Him. And so in just a moment, I'm going to invite you to give your life to Jesus. You know you're not living up to your potential and you've been doing it on your own. And today, you know that you need Jesus in your life. If that's you, I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm not going to bring you down forward or have you stand up. But I'm going to simply ask you to raise your hand. If you need God in your life, you need that transformation, if that's you, would you just lift up your hand all around this room? I'm giving my life to Jesus this afternoon. Awesome. You can lift it up and then put it, thank you, put it right back down. If you're listening online, you can pray this prayer with me. Let's pray it. You can either whisper it to heaven, you can repeat after me, or put it in your own words and say, Lord Jesus, I know that I've not measured up. I've fallen short of my potential. I've sinned. I know that I'm not capable, Lord, of pleasing You. But I'm thankful, Lord, that You've revealed how I can. That You died for me. That You did the work that I could not do. And so, Jesus, come into my heart. Erase my yesterdays. Fill me with the power of Your Holy Spirit so that I can walk out and live out Your purposes in my life. And I'll give You the praise and glory. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. You can stand up around this room. Hey, on your